Hey everyone, my name is Kevin Harris, and I want to welcome you today to worshipathome.online, the online ministry here of Cooper City Church of God. I'm one of the pastors here, and it's a delight for me to come into your home or wherever you are joining us today for this worship experience, whether you're worshiping with us on YouTube, on our Facebook channel, or on worshipathome.online. Welcome. We're glad to be with you today. I want to encourage you to do a couple of things. First of all, get your Bible ready. Either get your hard copy of your Bible in your hand or download a Bible at bible.com or in your iOS store. Go to YouVersion. Also, you can download the Cooper City Church of God app. Today in the app, you'll find today's teaching notes. Click on that tab and it'll open up a new page and it'll give you the digital notes of what we're going to be sharing from God's Word today. And I'm going to be asking a question in our teaching today: where can I find rest? Now, that's a broad question, and I believe that we can turn to the Word of God, and specifically, we're going to see from one passage of Scripture how that we can find rest for our weary souls and for all the things that we're facing in this nation that we live in and in the global pandemic. So no matter if you're watching here in America or if you're watching around the world, you're going to get something out of this today. Now, I don't know about you, but I got to be honest with you and transparent. I've had some restless nights over the last few weeks. One night just a couple of weeks ago, I woke up with a cramp in my leg and my calf had seized up on me and my muscle was causing excruciating pain, and I startled my wife and jumped up and got out of the bed and had to stretch out my muscle, and it was just a bad experience. Then there was another night where our internet went out, and we use a noisemaker in our bedroom and it creates this sound of a box fan, and it helps us to sleep and drowns out the sound of the noise as our bedroom faces a main street and the back of the house, and so it helps drown out some of the noise because sometimes people come barreling down that street in the wee hours of the morning. And the internet went out, and this noise box fan is a part of a sound that comes through our internet subscription. And so I wasn't woke up because of the sound. I was woke up because of the silence. And I immediately opened up my eyes and I was like, what happened? And suddenly I realized it was so quiet that I was awakened by that. And then on Tuesday night this past week, maybe some of you stayed up late and you were waiting for the election results to come in. And a lot of people stayed up that I understand till the wee hours of the morning anticipating a victory being announced, and it never came that night. And quite honestly, as I stand here later this week, as of this recording that is going to be aired on Sunday, we still don't know who the next president is going to be. But I just want to go on record and saying, even though we're recording this ahead of time, and by now on Sunday when you're watching this, maybe it has been completed. But the bottom line is, as I've been saying all along, it doesn't matter who's in the White House. We know that God is on the throne. And the fact of the matter is, I want to go on record and saying, my commander-in-chief wasn't even on the ballot. My commander-in-chief is on the throne of God today. In fact, if you go back to the Old Testament, let me just give you a little synopsis here. Joshua chapter 5 in verse 13, when Joshua was getting ready to seize Jericho and do what the Lord had instructed him to do, he was kind of taking into consideration all the things. And the Bible says in verse 13, when he got near, he looked up and he caught sight of a man standing in front of him. And the Bible says that he drew a sword. And Joshua said to him, "Are you on our side or are you on the enemy's side?" And the reply came in verse 14. He said, "I am neither. I am the commander of the Lord's armies." And so when we understand that our commander-in-chief today is not someone who has been elected, in fact, our commander-in-chief today is sitting at the right hand of the Father, and one day the trumpet is going to be blown, and he is going to come back to capture, to rapture up his bride. And so I'm glad to report to you today that no matter who the president of our nation is, and no matter who the president of other nations that may be watching this, and no matter who the kings and the princesses and the queens and the princes are of the nations around the world, our commander-in-chief is fully in control. And some have tried to snuff him out, and some have tried to extinguish him, some have tried to overthrow him, and some have even tried to abolish this book that teaches us about him. But he is still alive, and he is still well today, and he will never, ever be defeated. So regardless of the outcome, I just want to report that we're going to pray and we're going to support our next president as we have in years past, and we're going to believe that God is going to move upon him and help lead our country forward. And I just want to remind you, though, that, again, I'm not fixed on who is the leader in the White House. I'm fixed on Jesus. He is the author and the finisher of my faith. And we're going to one day be able to know that even though we may never get to meet the President of the United States in flesh, one day we're going to all be able to meet Jesus Christ face to face in heaven. And I can't wait for that day. Many of you have been praying with my family and I, and I shared this in the service this last week in campus in our in-person worship. Just this past week, we discovered that our parents, both of my parents, have been diagnosed with COVID-19. And while my mom has been home recovering, unfortunately, my father had to be taken to the hospital a week ago, and he has been moved into the intensive care unit and has been there for a number of days. And we're continuing to pray, and I have had to put into activation what I preached just this past Sunday. And I've been praying like Elijah. I've been praying with persistence, and I've been praying with expectation. And so many have asked how Dad is doing, and I just want you to know that he is set up for a great testimony when God performs a miracle in his life. He really needs a touch from God. He really needs a miracle. And I'm asking you to pray for me even now as I deliver this word. I need the strength of God. But it's easy for me to bring this word today, not because I'm squelching my emotions, because I believe God gave me this word. It was actually in the wee hours of Tuesday morning when a lot of people were glued to their TV trying to find out who the next president was going to be. My TV was off, and I woke up and I began to think about this psalm that we're going to talk about today. And it's in Psalm 91. And I want you to get your Bibles. We're going to go there. And as I was awoken early in the morning Tuesday, I normally wake up very early. I'm an early riser, but this was an unusual time. It was about 2:30 in the morning. And around 3 o'clock, I began thinking about this song. And actually Psalm 91, many years ago, a couple of decades ago, I wrote a song called I Will Trust in the Lord, and it's solely based upon Psalm 91. And so I've known this psalm for years, but how many of you know sometimes God can take the prism of the beauty of the scriptures and he can turn it and it reflects in a new way, and it just brings fresh and it brings rhema word like we talked about a few weeks ago. And that's what happened to me Tuesday morning. And as I was reading this and as I was reminding, and some of it I was just quoting it because I knew it so well, and I begin to remind myself of the promises of God. And I was restless that morning at about 2:30 or 3 o'clock in the morning. In fact, I could not go back to sleep for the remainder of that day, and I just stayed awake. And in the process of that, I said Tuesday morning. It was the wee hours on Wednesday morning after the electoral process had happened in our country. And so I just sat there, and I began to hear the Holy Spirit say things to me and remind me. And then I just felt prompted, like, there's someone else that needs to hear this. This is not just for Kevin today. And so today, I just want to kind of take a detour. We had some other things planned for today, and as we were moving towards Thanksgiving, we want to give you some encouragement and things to be thankful for. And we'll get to that soon. We still got a few weeks before Thanksgiving, and that's going to look a lot different for a lot of us this year, I know. But I just want to encourage you with the Word of God today. So I want you to get your Bible, Psalm 91. We're going to read the entirety, all 16 verses together, and I'm going to read from the New Living Translation. You can read along with me here on the screen. The Word of the Lord. Those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. This I declare about the Lord. He alone is my refuge, my place of safety. He is my God, and I trust him. For he will rescue you from every trap and protect you from deadly disease. He will cover you with his feathers. He will shelter you with his wings. His faithful promises are yours and your armor and your protection. Do not be afraid of the terrors of the night, nor the arrow that flies in the day. Do not dread the disease that stalks in darkness, nor the disaster that strikes at midday. Though 1,000 fall at your side and though 10,000 are dying around you, these evils will not touch you. Just open your eyes and see how the wicked are punished. If you make the Lord your refuge, if you make the Most High your shelter, no evil will conquer you. No plague will come near your home. For he will order his angels to protect you wherever you go, and they will hold you up with their hands. And so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone. You will trample upon lions and cobras, and you will crush fierce lions and serpents under your feet. The Lord says, I will rescue those who love me, and I will protect those who trust in my name. When they call on me, I will answer, and I will be there for them in time of trouble, and I will rescue and honor them. I will reward them with a long life and give them my salvation. May the Lord add his blessings to the reading of his word. As we read Psalm 91, we hear about hidden traps, deadly disease, plagues, terrors by night and arrows by day, stumbling over rocks and facing lions and snakes. However, in view of terrorist attacks and violence and reckless drivers and the global pandemic that we're facing, the contemporary scene may seem like it's just as dangerous, if not more dangerous, than the description here in this psalm. But it says the saints who abide in Christ, as described in verse 1, cannot avoid these unknown perils. However, they can escape these evil consequences. As it says in Psalm 91, verse 1, it said, those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow. Now, Moses is believed to be the author, according to Jewish tradition, that Moses wrote this, and he wrote it in the time that they were going through Israel and through the desert, rather, and he was leading over 1 million people through their own type of pandemic in the desert. And so when you see the servants of God, like Moses and David and Paul, who had struggles and faced great danger, there's also people that are listed in Hebrews, and it talks about that they were tortured. Look at what it says. Others were tortured, refusing to turn from God in order to be set free. They placed their hope in a better life after the resurrection, and some were jeered at. Their backs were cut open with whips. Others were chained in prisons, and some died by stoning. Some were sawed in half, rather, and others were killed by the sword. Now, this doesn't sound like a good outcome, and this sounds like a terrible fate, but just want to let you know that when we stand with a great cloud of witnesses that the Word talks about, there were many of our brothers and sisters and our forefathers in Christ who died for their faith. And today, I want to let you know, generally speaking, walking with the Lord helps us to detect and also avoid a great deal of trouble. That's what Psalm 91 is teaching us to a degree. And it is better to suffer in the will of God than to be outside the will of God and disobey Him and invite trouble. So Psalm 91 describes elements today of how you and I can find rest. So the question is today in our teaching, how can we find rest? Where can we find rest? So I believe we can find rest in a few places. And I want you to write these down. If you're not following along on the app, make sure you're writing these down, because I believe this word is going to help some of you today. I know it's encouraged me personally. I know it's been an encouragement to my family with what we're facing. And I believe it can be an encouragement to you. If not right now and immediately, you might want to store it away for sometime soon, because all of us are going to face a trial at some point in our life. The first place we can find rest is in the secret life that comes from peace in God. Now, we go back to verses 1-4, and we understand that when we talk about the secret life, I'm talking about the private portion, the behind scenes of our life that nobody sees but God. This secret life of worship and communion with God is symbolic of the Holy of Holies in this Jewish sanctuary. And if you go to Exodus chapter 25, verse 20, when he was given instructions to Moses on how to build the altar and how to build the Ark of the Covenant, look at what he says in verse 20. It says, the cherubim will face each other and look down at the atonement cover with their wings spread above it. They will protect it. This is a symbol, even with the construction of the Ark of the Covenant, where you and I are protected by God. In Psalms 91, verse 4, it says, he will cover you with his feathers, he will shelter you with his wings, his faithful promises are your armor and protection. Psalm 46, 1 says it this way, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. In a time of trouble, we know that God can hide us and he protects us so that we might not see the severity of some of the struggles of life that we all face and that we all go through. To better understand this, we can look again of how we can find this peace in God in Isaiah 31, verse 5, and it says, just as a bird hovers over its nest to protect its young, so I, the Lord Almighty, will protect Jerusalem and defend it. This verse is describing the Lord Almighty protecting us by spreading his wings over us. And so just imagine a young eaglet in its nest, and its brothers and sisters are there, and it's being looked upon by prey, and maybe there's something trying to come after it, and it begins to scream and cry out, and because of the danger that it senses that's coming, and all of a sudden the mother eagle swoops down and jumps upon the nest and hovers over them, and the mother's wings cover them, and suddenly, immediately in the shadow of those wings, their fears are relieved and the predator flees, and the eaglets once again are safe and protected. I put this in your notes. When we are in the shadow of God, the Lord will defend us, protect us, and deliver us from every kind of danger. I want to tell you today that the Church of the Living God, we are facing a lot of circumstances, but the Lord will surely come one day soon to liberate the church. And I believe that we are poised for revival. We were talking about this week as we were praying as a staff, and I said, I believe God's setting us up that we're going to see one of the greatest harvest seasons we've ever seen in 2021. I know none of us could have expected what we've realized over these last several months of 2020, but I'm looking forward with great hope that 2021 is going to be a year of deliverance, a year of hope, a year of revival, a year of repentance, to where we're going to see the hand of God rest upon us once again. We're going to see churches filled. We're going to see families restored. We're going to see broken relationships bound back together. And I believe that as we see that, we're going to say, look at what God has done. We're not going to be able to take credit for it. It's going to be astounding. It's going to be astonishing, and the world is going to take notice. Now, when you talk about shadows here in South Florida, we're accustomed to extreme heat and the sun beaming down from the sky. And when we walk out into the sunlight and the sunlight's blazing down, listen, it is good to find a shadow. It is good to find the shade of a tree or the shadow of a building that we're walking maybe in the city. And we find that and we welcome it. It is appreciated as a source of grace, blessing. Especially when it's on the hottest days. When it's the hottest is when you truly appreciate the shadow and that blessing. And let me tell you something. When you're going through the trial, sometimes it's in the darkest part of that hour that you really are thankful for those wings of protection overshadowing you. And I put this also in your notes, that the safest place in the world is a shadow. It is the shadow of the Almighty. Jesus pictured salvation in Matthew chapter 23, he talked about chicks hiding underneath the wing of its mother hen. And the psalmist here pictured communion with God as us as believers resting under the shadow of the cherubim's wing in the tabernacle. And so as he talked about this in Psalm 91, I thought it'd be cool to do a word study here. And there's several words that he used for God throughout Psalm 91. He used the word El Elyon, which is most high. This is found first in Genesis chapter 14. And it literally means that God is higher than all kings of the earth and all false gods of all the nations. He also used the word El Shaddai, which means almighty. This means that he's the all-sufficient God who is more than adequate to supply for us in every situation. He used the word Jehovah, Lord. It means this, the formal name of God who keeps his promises when he makes covenants with his people. He used Elohim, which is God, and it means that he is the powerful God whose greatness and glory surpasses anything that we can imagine about him. He's the God who also invites us into fellowship with him, into the Holy of Holies. So this secret life that we're talking about, first of all, is a component where we can find rest, and it's where we have a life of communion and a life of worship. But let me tell you, it's the secret life of worship that makes it possible for you and I to have the public life of obedience and service. You can't have the public life of Christianity without having a secret life of communion with God. And when we have this secret life, we have an assurance. We know that God shelters us beneath the wings of the cherubim, and his truth and faithfulness will always protect us, and we claim those promises over our life. Just as, like we talked about a few weeks ago in the Armor of God series, we talked about the shield of faith, and we talked about it being a full body shield where you put that shield in front of you and it protects your whole body. You literally can stand behind it. And the message is clear again here in Psalm 91, that for those of us who abide in the Lord, we are saved in the shelter of his wings. So the first place that we can find rest is in the secret life. And then there's the second way we can find rest, and that is in the protected life. And that's what I call as a result of the peace of God that talks about in verses 5 through 13. Listen, when you and I dwell in the secret life with God in communion, we are not alone because we know that God is with us. And then he compensates for our inadequacies. Psalm 91 emphasizes that we do not need to be afraid because the Lord and his angels are watching over us. And in the ancient times when Moses was writing this, travel was dangerous. In fact, it was treacherous at times. And if you didn't have a protection, an army or guards with you, there was a real reason to be afraid, not only of the terror that could happen in the darkness. And a lot of fear came in the dark times of the night in that pitch black desert. But then during the day, when people could see you, you could succumb to attacks of the arrows that would fly and hurl in your direction. And so verses 7 and 8 read like the description of a battle that may have a direct relationship to the covenant promises of God that he made with Israel all the way back in Deuteronomy chapter 32. And with their eyes, the children of Israel saw this firsthand. They saw the grief of the Egyptians when they had lost their firstborn in the plague. And they saw all these children and the firstborn who had died on Passover night. But as long as they had placed the blood of atonement over their door, and they knew that they were going to be protected, and their firstborn children still lived. They also, as children in bondage in Egypt, the children of Israel saw when they fled, that after they crossed the ground where the sea was, they saw the sea envelop and close up behind them and consume and drown the army. And they saw these throngs of soldiers from the most powerful force of artillery on the face of the planet at that time. They saw them die right there at the hand of God. And in this moment, through all of this, no harm came to God's people. He protected them. His angel went before them to prepare a way and to lead the way. And I just wanted to come by to remind some of you today, because maybe you've been questioning, where is God in all these problems, and what's been going on, and why doesn't he hear my prayers? His protection is with you. And when you know you're protected, listen, that's when you have peace and you can breathe again and you can know that everything's going to be all right. It may not be the outcome that you chose. It may not be the outcome that I chose. But as long as we're submissive to his will, we understand this powerful statement that the shadow of God is much more safer than the reality of this world. So when we try to find peace in any other source than God, we always are going to feel exposed. We'll never truly feel safe, because there is no peace that is found in this troubled world except for the peace that we can only find in Jesus. So Psalm 91, we discover a couple of ways already that we can find rest, the secret life that comes from peace, the protected life that is a result of peace from God. And then thirdly, lastly, I want to share this with you today, the satisfied life that is a result of our love for God. Now, the Lord announced what he would do for the people that truly loved him. Look at what it says in verse 16. Actually, in verse 14, if you back up a little bit, he says, I will rescue those who love me, and I will protect those who trust in my name. He said, when they call on me, I will answer. He says, I will be with them in time of trouble. Listen, verse 14, the word, when he says, those who love me, it's a different translation of the word love than is used in most other translations when you look at this from the Hebrew. This word love here means to cling to cleave, to be passionate. So it means that when we're passionate in our love for God, this same word that was also used in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 7, it talks about the love that God has for his people Israel. It means that when we understand that we're in love with God and that God loves us in return, that we are protected, that we have the blessings of protection and deliverance and answered prayers and companionship in times of trouble, even in times of good and even in times of honor. And listen, he goes on to say that when you have these moments, that I'm going to honor you and you're going to have a satisfied life. That's why I say that this satisfied life is something that the Lord wants for you today. It's something, it doesn't matter how young you are, how old you are, God wants you to have a full and satisfied life. Look at what he says. He says, I will reward them with a long life and give them my salvation. Now, the word salvation here that is mentioned in Psalm 91, it gives us this promise of the reward of long life. And it's an understanding to know that the most powerful meaning of this full and satisfied life really comes from the Jewish tradition. They believe that living a long life, being able to see your children and your grandchildren, even to see your great-grandchildren, that is the ultimate blessing of life. And like Abraham, that was talked about in Genesis chapter 25, verse 8, it says, Abraham breathed his last and died in a good old age, an old man full of years. God wants that for each of us. And even though we're on this sin-cursed side of eternity, and even though there's sickness and disease and the pandemic and all the stuff that's going on and creating chaos in our world that we're living in right now, I've been seeing the updates from my friends and dear companions in ministry down in Central America and in the country that I love so dearly of Honduras, and I'm seeing the floods, multiple feet of rain, not inches, feet of rain have fallen there. And they're trying to, even today, as the clouds have lifted and the storm has moved on, they're trying to figure out how to put the pieces of their life back together. Even in the midst of storms that seem to overtake you like a flood, God still loves you, and God can still give you peace. and God can still give you rest. Listen, even in a week like we've suffered through as a family, and we're listening to reports given to us throughout the day, multiple times a day, from doctors and nurse practitioners and nurses, and we're hearing from my mom and being able to hear from them on behalf of my dad because he's wearing a mask right now and it's difficult for him to communicate. Even in those moments, let me tell you, with all the thanks that I can give for medical advancement, and I thank God for the physicians and all the things that they can do, their attempt to add years to my life of my father pales in comparison to what God can do for my dad. He will give life not only to his years, but he will give a full and satisfied life to not only my father, but to you and to everyone who is listening to this and to the sound of my voice today. I want you to know that as we move towards the close of this teaching, I want to declare some words, and I want you to say these words with me. And I know right now I'm preaching a recorded message, and it's going to be aired this weekend. And so this is an empty room right now. And through technology, we upload this and put it on servers so we make sure we don't have any breakdown, and so you can get all of this without interruption. And we work hard to create the technology to be able to do that. So as you're watching this, whether it's for the first time it's being aired on Sunday morning, or if you're watching a rebroadcast of it later throughout the week, I want you to think about these things. And I want you to understand that you can say these things with me. And I believe I have them there. No, I don't. I just want you to agree with me. First of all, this is true. There is protection in the shadow of the Almighty. How many of you believe that? I hope you have it there in your notes. It's not here on the screen. But how many of you know there is protection in the shadow of the Almighty? In other words, what we've already read from Psalm 91, under the shadow of God's wings, we find divine protection. Here's another thing I believe. In the shadow of the Almighty, everything is made new. Listen, 2020 has been a year of first. It's been a year of a lot of things. I mean, when we're now in November, looking back over the past 10 months or so, it seems like every day something has changed. In fact, some days it seems like it's not just that day, every hour of that day, something had changed. And not just a little change, not a minor change, but I mean drastic changes. And I would have never imagined at the beginning of 2020, I would have never imagined in my life that there would ever come a time where we would have to close the doors of a church, that we could no longer gather in person because of the threat of this disease that has consumed our society and blanketed over the globe. But instead of grumbling about this crisis and being disheartened about the inability to gather for worship, I have chose to be reminded that the Lord is doing something new in our midst. You know, even me recording these teachings and putting it out for you to be able to worship with us on the weekends and throughout the week, it's a different thing. It's different for me to come in and preach to an empty room, but preach to a camera. But we've started doing this because we believe, like, the Lord prompted us to say, you know what? You're going to have to do things a little bit different, but I'm still going to anoint it. I'm still going to bless it. I'm still going to use it effectively for my glory. In fact, when I understood that the church of God, when it's going through, and the kingdom of God, when it's going through trials and times of testing, it will never diminish, but it will only cause us to be stronger. And soon and very soon, I declare, we're going to come out of this and we're going to expand as a greater force. And that was what God's intention for us has always been. I declare this over our life today. In the shadow of the Almighty, there is rest. There is rest. As children of God, we're in a difficult time. Everything seems like it's beyond our control. But I want to encourage you today, don't lose heart. Let us also decide not just to come back to church, but for some of us to come back to God and give him our time and give him the honor and the glory that is due him, his name and him alone. And may we never make our busy schedules excuses for not spending time with our God. His word and his fellowship is something that we must have. It's the communion and worship in the secret place that affords us the ability to be obedient openly and in public. So I want to give you these last few scriptures, and I hope I have them here. Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. It says this, church, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he's done. You know, this is what happened to me the other morning. It was dark outside and it was quiet. I was in the living room by myself alone, and I was in a place where I would not disrupt anybody else who was resting in my home. And I just began to list all the things that I was thankful for. I think the enemy was trying to attack me personally and was trying to let me know that all these things could happen, and maybe there's a demise that's going to happen in this way, and this disease and this sickness is about to cause these things to happen. And in that moment, I just began to thank God for all that he had already provided. I began to thank him for my life. I began to thank him for the leadership and the great fatherly example that I have in my dad, Gary Harris. I began to thank him for my mom. I began to thank him for the stripes that he's taken upon his back for the healing of every sickness and disease. And I just began to feel my spirit and my faith. Even as I'm saying this now, I begin to feel it elevate. And there's just something that came into that room and encouraged me. And I hope it encourages you today. Begin to thank God for what he's done. And when you begin to list all the things he's done for you, something begins to happen in the atmosphere. Because I'm going to tell you, I could live the rest of my life if he never did anything for me and just praise him for the past experiences of what he's already done. And I believe I'm talking to some people who can resonate with that. Yes, it's been bad. Yes, it's been tough. But don't forget, look back over your shoulder. He's brought us a mighty, mighty long way, and I'm so thankful for that today. This last scripture I want to share with you, these are the words of Jesus himself in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. In the New King James, it says this, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." The safest place for us to be is in the shadow of the Almighty. In the shadow of God's wings, there is protection today, church. In the shadow of everything that will be made new. And in the shadow, we know that we can find perfect rest for our souls. How many of you would be honest right now? How many of you would say, "Kevin, I've been restless"? Maybe you've had some sleepless nights. I don't know what you've been worried about. Maybe you've had some sickness in your family like we have recently. Maybe you've had some sleepless nights over what's going on with this crazy election. You know, I don't know why the election has not been as crazy as it has been, because look at what everything else has gone on in 2020. It's almost like we should have expected it. Maybe you've had restless nights over a lost job or difficulty in your finances. I don't know what it is that's been keeping you up at night, but as I ask that question, what keeps you up at night, I want to ask you this question. Is your God not big enough to handle that on your behalf? Because if you can't say yes to that, you're the people I need to pray for right now. If you've allowed the focus of your vision to become consumed with your challenges and with your problems that are set before you, you need to get around that problem and you need to refocus yourself and allow the image of God to come into full focus. Now, I'm going to pray for that to happen right now in Jesus' name. Would you pray with me? Father, for those that have been restless, for those that are having difficulty finding rest, I speak peace, the peace of God that passes all understanding. I don't have the authority to speak this on behalf of me as an ordained bishop or as a minister of the gospel, but I do have the authority to speak it on behalf of you, God. Because of what we've read today in Psalm 91, and because of what we read just now in Matthew, it says that we can come to you when we're weighted down and when we're burdened and when we're struggling, oh God. And you yourself, Jesus, you said, "You will find rest in me." And so today, with authority, God, and with full confidence, I square my shoulders and say, we have peace in Jesus. The world doesn't know about this peace. The world will not find peace, no matter what the outcome of the election is. The world will not find this peace, no matter what the doctor's diagnosis may or may not say. The world will not find this peace, no matter what stimulus may still come or what their bank account says. No, our peace is not in those things, God. Our peace is in our communion, in our worship, in our relationship with you. Because if we don't have peace in God, we don't have peace at all. So I speak peace over your people today. For those that have been restless, for those that have been weary, oh God, I'm asking you to touch them right now. I'm asking you to speak peace into their lives. May it be supernatural. May it be such a way that they can't explain it away any other way, but the hand of God has rested upon them. And God, we give you thanks. We give you praise. But I believe you're accomplishing it even right now in Jesus' strong and mighty name. Say amen with me in agreement. Amen. I believe for that peace over your life. As we close today, at any point of this service, if you've asked the Lord, Jesus Christ, to come into your life and be the forgiver of your sins. He is the only person that can do that. He's the only one that has accomplished the work that needed to be done on the finished work of Calvary, as we talked about earlier in this service in communion. He has already done what needed to be accomplished. And so to provide a way for you to say yes to him, and he can come into your heart and he can be the forgiver of your sins, and you can make him the Lord of your life. If you've done that today, text the word forgive just type the word forgive and text it to the number on the screen, 954-951-4747. We're going to send you a free resource today. It's one of the things that we're so elated and we're filled with joy every time we get one of these texts. And we send this resource out to you because what that lets us know is that someone has said yes to Jesus Christ today. And by doing so, you're going to begin your new journey with God, and you're going to begin to find peace even in the midst of the storm, even in the midst of the circumstance. Yes, even in the midst of the pandemic, peace is yours today. So may the peace of God be yours. May you indeed rest under the shadow of the Almighty, and may we know that He alone is our refuge and our strength. In Him we will put our trust. God bless you. I love you today. I look forward to worshiping with you again soon.